Hisham B. Sharabi Memorial Lecture is entitled Statelessness as the Core of the Palestinian Issue. Our lecturer today is Professor Juan Cole. Professor Cole is the Mitchell Collegiate Professor of History at the University of Michigan. He has written extensively on modern Islamic movements in Egypt, the Persian Gulf, and South Asia, and has given numerous media interviews on the war on terrorism and the Iraq war. His most recent book is Engaging the Muslim World, and his Napoleon's Egypt Invading the Middle East was published in 2007. Many of you may know him well from his popular online blog, which he started in 2002, called Informed Comment. So please join me in welcoming Professor Cole to deliver the Sharabi Memorial Lecture, Statelessness as the Core of the Palestinian Issue.
Well, thank you very much, Yusuf, for that warm introduction. Thank you to the Jerusalem Fund for this prestigious invitation. It's a great honor and pleasure for me to be here and to address you. Turn on the technology here. Is that all right?
Yes.
Okay. More technology. I want to make an argument about the character of the Palestine issue. I'm not going to argue that it's a unique problem, but I am going to argue that it's almost unique in contemporary affairs, and that there are some aspects of it that explain why it is so seemingly intractable. I'm going to start with a increasingly important field of study, citizenship studies. There are journals now devoted to it. It's become a big thing in academia. My colleague at the University of Michigan, Margaret Summers, wrote an important book on citizenship not so long ago. And as she points out, Chief Justice Earl Warren of the U.S. Supreme Court in 1958 wrote, Citizenship is man's basic right, for it is nothing less than the right to have rights. Remove this priceless possession, and there remains a stateless person, disgraced and degraded in the eyes of his countrymen. So Warren is drawing here implicitly on the work of Hannah Arendt, but this is the key point that I want to make today. Citizenship is the right to have rights. People who lack citizenship in a state, ipso facto, have no right to have rights. Now, citizenness, the quality of being a citizen, is of course not one data point, it's not one thing, and it exists, as with all social phenomena, on a spectrum. You know, it's like coolness. It can be more or less cool. There are attributes that contribute to one's coolness. Speaking as an expert, citizenness likewise is on a spectrum. Summers brings in a number of things that make for citizenship, the intersection with the state, how strong is the state, how much recognition by the state is there of a particular group as citizens, relationship to the market. So I come from the Detroit area where there's a very large number of young people in Detroit who have no access to the market. They don't live where there are jobs. They're not suited to the jobs that are in their neighborhoods, if there are any. They're disconnected to the market. And Summers argues that that's also a problem of citizenship, a full citizenship. And then civil society non-governmental organizations of various sorts? How thick are they on the ground? How interactive are they with local people? So Summers argues that what we discovered after the Katrina hurricane was that very large numbers of people in New Orleans, not actually citizens very much, that they had low levels of citizenship in American terms. The state really didn't do much for them. They weren't connected to the market, et cetera, et cetera. So as I said, she wants to put this on a scale of low to high. Now, if we took the Palestinians, the Israelis, and the Jordanians as a test case and looked at their relationship to these three factors, this is notional, you know, I don't have Greek numbers behind these charts, but if we just thought about it, the Israelis have a relatively strong state, and the Israeli citizens have a strong relationship to that state. Obviously, the Palestinian Israelis don't have as much citizenship as Jewish Israelis, but they do have rights of citizenship. For instance, the Israelis set things up so that they only recognize municipalities if they have been incorporated in a certain way, and they don't give permission to a lot of the Palestinian Israeli villages to incorporate. And without that permission, then they can't repair and get permits and so forth. In fact, there are some of them that the Likud party in the 70s came to and said, we'll recognize you as proper Israeli municipalities if only you'll vote for us. So there's a reliable Likud vote to this day in some of those places. But on the whole, and by and large, the Israelis have citizenship and they have a strong state. Obviously, it is a country with a vigorous market and a strong relationship of people to that market. Very active non-governmental organization sector, and I think across the board in this regard. So the Israelis, you know, they have one-third, one-third, one-third. That's a normal distribution for citizenship, according to Summers. And then the Jordanians, you know, their state is weaker. The Palestinian Jordanians are not as connected to it as the East Bank Bedouin population, and you have a couple hundred thousand Iraqis, and now 10% of the country is Syrian, and so it's a mess. But the Jordanian citizens, you know, do have citizenship, so it's not as robust a citizenship category as in Israel, but it's there, and then. The market is complicated in Jordan because so much of it is off the books. But if you counted the black market, then people are pretty connected to it. And then it's a fairly lively NGO scene. So I would say the Jordanian chart is a little distorted from Summers' point of view, weaker state, a strange kind of market, and so forth, but still all three categories are there. But if we came to the Palestinians, their situation of citizenship is obviously deformed. There's no state. They're lacking an entire section of the column. And then their market is not very robust, and of course in Gaza there is no market to speak of. The Israelis have Gaza under siege. There's no airport, there's no harbor, and the Israelis don't permit the Palestinians in Gaza to export most of what they make. Some strawberries, off of which the Israelis take a cut. But mostly, the export market doesn't exist in Gaza. So the market and the separation wall and the politics of the neighboring states are such that the Palestinians don't have a strong relationship to the market. They don't have a state at all. There are a lot of NGOs. And so for the Palestinians, the NGO sector is the one place where there's a little glimmer maybe of some citizenship. But that's weird. And that's unexampled in the world. There's no other group of people that look like that in the world right now. So this problem of citizenship and the Palestinians, of course, goes back to the early 20th century. The Palestinians, the Iraqis, and the Syrians were recognized after World War I as Class A mandates coming out of the old Ottoman Empire. The League of Nations had a paternalistic rhetoric that nations were kind of like people, and they were at various ages of development. So the Syrians, Iraqis, and Palestinians were 16. You know, they just about ready to get a driver's license, not ready to vote yet. And the League of Nations actually talked about them as adolescents. I mean, there was a paternalistic juvenilization of people. You know, when George W. Bush said the Iraqis were just about ready to take off the training wheels, so what, they were three? That rhetoric is not new. I mean, you heard things like that in 1920 after World War I as well from the European powers. So the French and the British were designated to be their mentors. You know how Robin is Batman's ward. So they were supposed to grow them up to the point where they could stand on their own feet. Well, not everybody in the world was a Class A mandate. There were Class B mandates. So, you know, the Syrians, the Iraqis, and the Palestinians were relatively well thought of by the Europeans in this regard. And so they thought, well, there'll be a period of mandatory rule by the Europeans, and then eventually they'll be independent. And that was the charge. I mean, unlike previous colonizations, which were just looting, you know, when the British went into India, there were no promises they were going to mature the Indians. They were mainly just interested in taking money out of the country. In this case, they were given a responsibility to set these countries up on their own feet and let them become proper members of the League of Nations. It was complicated in the case of Palestine because of the Balfour Declaration. In the course of World War I, this crackpot Englishman who thought Jews ruled the world wanted to make the Jews happy so that the British would win World War I and therefore promised them a homeland in Palestine without saying what a homeland was, and promising at the same time that it wouldn't inconvenience the Palestinians. You see why I used the word crackpot. And so the mandatory documents about Palestine from the League of Nations are weird in the sense all the other charters for the mandatory states talk about this process of standing them up on their own feet and so forth. But in Palestine, there's a lot of language about the Jews, of which at that time there weren't very many. The Italians and the French, if you go back in the correspondence of the League of Nations, pressed the British on this. They said, you can't just like disregard the rights of the local people. The problem of statelessness in the early 20th century was severe. Nations, as a matter of course, used statelessness as a ruthless political tool. And so when the White Russians lost the rebellion against the new Soviet regime, the Soviets took away their citizenship in the millions. The Armenians were deprived of citizenship. Hungarians were deprived of citizenship. The Spaniards on the left who fought Franco, when they lost, often were denaturalized. There were 500,000 Spanish without citizenship. I think probably Picasso was one of them. And the French gave him citizenship. So, of course, it was a policy of the Nazis when they came to power to start depriving people of citizenship. Now, we tend to forget this now that millions of Europeans in the 30s were deprived of their citizenship. They were denaturalized. They were left without the right to have rights. And Hannah Arendt points out that with regard to the Nazis, this policy of denaturalizing people or leaving them without citizenship rights was a demonstration project. That is to say, the Nazis began by thinking that Gypsies and Jews and other groups are flotsam and the scum of the earth and a kind of infection in the body politic. And by taking away their citizenship, they demonstrated that they're scum. So Goebbels said that depriving the Jews of citizenship made the Jews the scum of the earth. And he said, you know, let's see. Everybody's criticizing us how we treat our Jews, but will they take them? Does America want them? Does Britain want them? And of course, they didn't once they were stateless. So by marking them as non-German, as taking away German Jews' citizenship, the Nazis then were demonstrating the worthlessness of their Jews. And ironically enough, mandatory Palestine under British rule, served this function of being a refuge for stateless Jews at this point. And in fact, this was one of the arguments that proponents of Jewish immigration to Palestine made. So for instance, in 1938-39, when you had a British MacDonald White Paper after the 1936 through 39 Palestinian uprising, which argued that henceforward Jewish immigration into Palestine should be limited, there was an outcry among the Zionists in Europe that at that time, in 39, the Sudetenland in Czechoslovakia was taken over by the German Nazis, and they denaturalized 100,000 Jews there. And people said, well, where would they go if you don't let them go to Palestine? So Palestine was a solution to the increasing statelessness of the European Jewry. Let me stop at this juncture and consider some possible twists or objections on this theory of citizenship that many people have said to me, well, there are lots of people in the world who don't have proper rights. So for instance, undocumented immigrants. Well, undocumented immigrants don't have rights of citizenship in the country where they are because they're undocumented. Haven't gotten there legally. They still do have citizenship. And the United States deports 400,000 of them a year back to their countries of origin where they are citizens. When Palestinians are deported from the West Bank by the Israelis, where are they deported to? Gaza or Jordan?
Cyprus?
Not to their country. They're deported. They're not really being deported in the technical sense of going back to your country of origin, right? They're being expelled to other places. They're still stateless. The situation of Palestinians is not like that of undocumented workers because they're stateless. And undocumented workers mostly are not stateless. They just don't have citizenship in the place where they're working. Then people say, well, what about the Basque and the Kurds and the Catalan? They don't want to be, you know, they have the citizenship they have. Well, I agree that that's a little bit unfortunate not to have the citizenship that you want, but it's different from not having any at all. So the Turkish Kurds may suffer some disabilities from being Kurdish in Turkey, but they still are Turkish citizens. They vote. In fact, they're influential in the elections, and they have the ability to work and so forth. So that's an aspiration for separatism is a different situation than statelessness. It's not the same thing. And then, you know, there are citizens of states that don't amount to much. I mean, I don't know how much good it does you to be a Somali citizen. There was Iraq under American rule. What kind of a citizen were you there? But still, it doesn't have the same implications for you as statelessness. Statelessness means the complete lack of citizenship in a recognized state. It means you don't have a passport, you have a laissez-passer. It means a lot of countries won't accept the laissez-passer. It means you can't travel freely, you don't have constitutional protections, you often can't get a work permit. Your property is not secure because people can take it away from you and you don't have access to national courts that could adjudicate those disputes. It's different. So after World War II, this problem of the interwar period of millions of stateless was resolved. And the bias in international law was against people being denaturalized, against statelessness. And so statelessness became rare. Out of 7 billion human beings today, the United Nations High Commission on Human Rights estimates perhaps 12 million are stateless. Of those, you know, there are 90,000 Bedouin in Kuwait, tribes that used to wander amidst states and then got caught on the Kuwaiti side of the border and can't move now and are not recognized by the emir as Kuwaiti, although the Kuwaitis have hired them as their policemen. I guess the emir figures they won't be loyal to other tribes. Then 300,000 Syrian Kurds were denaturalized by the Ba'ath, or the pre-Ba'ath actually, it was Arab nationalists anyway, in the 60s, which have grown to now probably over a million. And people have alleged to me that the situation of Kurds under the Ba'athis in Syria, say in the 90s, was actually worse than the situation of Palestinians. Both were stateless in Syria. People get caught. There were 100,000 Taiwanese in Japan in 1971 when Japan unrecognized the Taiwanese government. For all purposes, the Taiwanese in Japan suddenly became stateless. But that's been resolved over time. But the very largest group of stateless people in the world, the largest single group, are the Palestinians. And you all know in this audience very well the story. There were over a million Palestinians in 1943 in mandatory Palestine, about half a million Jewish settlers who had bought up about 7% of the land. But then in 1947-48, as the British prepared to withdraw, a civil war broke out between the two communities. In which the Yishuv, the budding community that became Israel, conducted a campaign of ethnic cleansing against the Palestinians, which displaced them in very large numbers, probably on the order of 730,000 out of the 1.3 million Palestinians of that time were displaced, many of them went to the West Bank or Gaza, Jordan, Lebanon, Syria, a few in Egypt. And of course, those who were displaced to the West Bank and Gaza in 67, many of them were again displaced. Well, we take a place like Lebanon. The Palestinians who came into Lebanon grew over time demographically. The UN estimates on the order of 400,000, 450,000. Probably they are less because many have surreptitiously emigrated to Europe in the meantime. But in any case, however many there are, most still live in camps. Lebanese law does not allow them to have property rights. For the most part, there's been a slight adjustment of this, but for the most part, they can't get work permits, they can't get business permits. I mean, you visit the Palestinians in their camps in Lebanon, and they're in jail. I mean, they're like prisoners. They can't get out. They don't, you know, the other countries won't accept their travel documents for fear that they'll stay. The camps themselves are lawless. I mean, you think about a place, it's a place that Lebanese sovereignty doesn't really extend very far into. So it's not as if there are like police. And people organize these militias for self-protection, but the militias can be predatory, and some guys can get guns and prey on others. So it's a horrible situation, and it's been going on now since 48. I visited the former Palestinian camp of Nahr el-Bared. And this is, you know, I met an old man there who told me the story of how in 48 he was with his mother in an apartment in Haifa, and the Zionists came and told them to leave at gunpoint. And so they went north, and they waited there on the Lebanese border to go back. And then, of course, Ben-Gurion announced that he would close the borders and they couldn't go back. And they were there for a year. And then the UN put them on trains and took them up to Tripoli, very far away from their home. And they've been there ever since in camps. So Nahr el-Bared was a camp. And because, frankly, of the lawlessness of camp life, nevertheless, there are some opportunities there that don't exist elsewhere for unregulated commercial exchange, let us say. And so over time, Nahr el-Bared started to have some money. And there was a lot of commerce there, maybe some commerce that couldn't be conducted elsewhere. People gentrified their buildings, and there were shops, and it became a town of 70,000, and it was a relatively nice town. But then, because there's no police and it's lawless and so forth, in the middle of the last decade, about 50 guys formed a gang that started robbing banks in Tripoli, which angered the Lebanese government. And then these guys who were robbing banks, for reasons that I can't entirely understand, announced that they were an Al-Qaeda affiliate. What do you get from doing that? I mean, does Al-Qaeda give you a gold star? Or what benefit is there in saying that? Well, I know the downside is that all of a sudden Dick Cheney's on the phone with the Lebanese government saying you have to go in there. And anyway, these guys were robbing banks and causing trouble. So the Lebanese army invaded Nahr el-Bared, a civilian settlement of 70,000 people. And that I'm showing slides of it. It's destroyed now. It's gone. People are again refugees, and they're living in prefab UN little apartments. The old man took me by, who had been expelled from Haifa, took me by the arm and brought me to one of the rooms, and there were two old women there on oxygen, and he said, "Is this a way to live?" So when you're stateless, you don't have the right to have rights. So everything is unstable. It's a little bit like being a child of an alcoholic, abusive family. They suffer from everything always being interrupted. You never know what's going to happen. You can't make plans. Let's go for a picnic today, but then the picnic doesn't happen because the parent got drunk. Well, if you're stateless, you don't really know what's going to happen to you. Your property is unstable. Your rights are unstable. Even if you were stateless and you get citizenship, your citizenship is unstable. So Jordan gave citizenship to the West Bank Palestinians at one point. And then because of the Rabat Accords after Israel conquered it, they took the Jordanian citizenship back away. They just denaturalized about 30 or 40,000 Palestinians from Gaza and Jordan. So if you were stateless, the stigma of statelessness seems to attach to you even if you get citizenship, and then that is unstable. It can be taken back away. And then you never know when you'll be refugees again. Palestinians in Gaza, on the other hand, were not granted Egyptian citizenship, were ruled by Egypt 49 to 67, and then directly ruled by Israel since 67 to 2005, during which the Israelis thought it would be a good idea to try to put Israeli settlers into this densely populated, resource-poor area. Since 2005, the Israelis felt like they couldn't really protect those settlers. and so took them back out, but they didn't make any agreement with the Palestinians in Gaza about the post-withdrawal situation, leaving the Palestinians in limbo. They have no harbor. They have no airport. They had an airport. The Israelis bombed it. It's hard to take off if there are holes in the tarmac. And then the Bush administration thought it would be a good idea to hold elections in 2006 and insisted on letting Hamas run. When Hamas won, the Bush administration and the Israelis connived at overthrowing the Hamas government and succeeded in doing so in the West Bank, but not in Gaza. Now the Western press, whenever it talks about Hamas in Gaza, talks about it having made a coup there. Would it have been the other way around? Like, the coup was over on the West Bank. These guys were elected. But in any case, to punish the Palestinians for voting for Hamas, and of course, not all the Palestinians in Gaza voted for Hamas. 50% of the Palestinians in Gaza are children. But to punish all of the Palestinians in Gaza for voting for Hamas, Israelis subjected them to a blockade from 2007. The Israeli Ministry of Defense actually sat down and figured out that each adult person needs 2,200 calories. And how many trucks of food would you let in every day to keep them svelte? Not starving to death, but not with any baby fat either. No chocolate for the children. I mean, this is creepy. It's weird. I mean, it's repulsive. Actually, one of my victories in life was that I called it creepy at my blog. And the National Review at one point published an article trying to refute me, and it quoted me as saying that the blockade was creepy. So I inserted that meme into the National Review, even though they were trying to wiggle out of it. So this is a population that has been without citizenship for 61 years. And apparently, if you're without citizenship, you not only don't have a right to have rights, you don't have a right to have chocolate or more than 2,200 calories a day. Your body becomes an experimental field for planners on the part of your enemies. On the West Bank, as I said, the Jordanians did grant citizenship to the Palestinians, but after 67, and after the Jordan and the Arab League recognized the PLO as sole Palestinian spokesman, Jordanian citizenship ultimately was revoked, and so they're formally stateless. So the implications of this are that they lack control, because what does a state do? It controls land, water, air. If a North Korean MiG flew over San Diego, all hell would break loose. Why? It would have penetrated the airspace of the United States of America, of the federal government. The airspace is owned by the government. If an Israeli plane flies over the West Bank, not a state. If substantial water resources, a river or something, were expropriated by Canada, there would be trouble, because that's America's water. It's owned by the federal government. But if 85% of the water on the West Bank is diverted to Israeli settlers, that's all right, because there is no Palestinian state. The water doesn't belong to anybody. It's a no man's land. States control immigration. I said the United States nowadays deports 400,000 people a year for coming here without proper procedures or documentation. It was 1 million a year not so long ago. It's really a vast bureaucracy. The Palestinians would deport somebody how? There are lots of undocumented people on the West Bank, but their state is behind them. Aquifer rights are interfered with. The Israeli settlers can dig their tube wells deeper than the Palestinians and cause the aquifer to fall, and so the old wells of the Palestinian villages dry up. The Israelis have, as you all know, set up a vast network of checkpoints, of special highways on which Palestinians can't drive. They've made it difficult to get from one part of Palestine to the other. There must be a whole class, you know, a postmodern novelist should write about the class of Palestinians born at checkpoints because their mom couldn't get through in time to the hospital. So there's difficulty of travel, lack of speedy hospital access. Of course, there aren't proper medical facilities for many diseases in Gaza, and Palestinians in Gaza have to apply to the Israeli government to get permission to go out of the Gaza Strip for treatment. And in a few cases, the permission hasn't quite come in time. They're stateless. They have no right to have rights. They have no right to have medical care. So Palestinians rate low on citizenship in a state. One of the riposte to my argument is sometimes, well, there's the Palestine Authority, the Palestinians have a state, there's just not a very good one. Well, the Palestine Authority doesn't look like a proper state in most regards. It doesn't have control of the things that a state controls. So Palestinians rate low on citizenship in a state. They rate low on access to or incorporation into a market. There is some civil society, that's circumscribed by the Palestine Authority and by the Israelis. So one of the things you've seen in the past couple years is that the Palestine Authority, which has now changed its name to just Palestine, I approve, has gone to the United Nations and asked for the status of an observer state. Some journalists have said they asked for recognition of a state, as a state. This is not true. They already believed that they were a state. They weren't asking for recognition of that. They were asking for a particular kind of status at the UN, which is called the observer state status. And it's enjoyed previously only by the Vatican. The United States and Israel fought tooth and nail against this. And of course, the United Nations Security Council hasn't signed off on it, but the General Assembly now last fall did recognize them in this way. And the reason that the Palestinians wanted this status is that as international law has evolved, you now have an international criminal court. There begin to be, because of the Statute of Rome, some ways of adjudicating certain kinds of torts, of wrongs done by one state to the people of another, that can only be accessed by another state. That is to say, in the law, standing is very important. Do you have standing to sue? Do you have standing to participate in a legal settlement of some sort? And the Palestinians, being stateless, did not have standing in international law. It's another problem with being stateless. No tort can be committed against you because you have no standing, or no tort can be adjudicated. So what Palestine was doing in seeking UN observer state status was to begin to establish standing to pursue tort cases against the Israelis, who daily are breaking international law. They're breaking the Hague Convention of 1907. They're breaking the Geneva Convention on Occupied Territories of 1949 daily. They're also contravening large numbers of UN Security Council resolutions. At one time or another, the Americans have occasionally let things through. But it's quite a body of UN Security Council resolutions about Jerusalem, about the West Bank, and so forth, which the Israelis disregard. And so there is a set of cases to be made, but the Palestinians were not able to make that case as long as they didn't have standing, as long as they didn't have this state observer status. And as you can tell, I think that this is exactly the right strategy. It is the strategy of beginning to establish Palestinian claims on citizenship. The statelessness of the Palestinians is virtually unknown as an issue in the United States. If you did a poll among Americans, are Palestinians without citizenship rights? Almost none of them would know this. On the other hand, everybody in the Middle East knows it. So it is one of the problems, of course, for American foreign policy. American foreign policy towards the Palestinians, on the whole and by and large, is to screw them over. Not because the United States hates Palestinians, although maybe some officials do, but because it pleases their ally Israel to have these policies. So the WikiLeaks revelation of State Department cables about Israeli policy in the blockade of Gaza demonstrate that these Americans in the U.S. Embassy in Tel Aviv were gung-ho. They were perfectly willing to help half-starve the Palestinian children in Gaza. I was taken aback by the language of these cables, and they were very hard. I mean, they might as well have been written by the Likud party. I'm sure there are, officials in the U.S. government who know the score and so forth, but practically speaking, de facto, the U.S. is complicit in the Palestinian statelessness and in keeping them in that status. And this obviously causes problems for the U.S. in the region. Nobody can understand why the U.S. Would want to do that to these poor people. What is the end game here? What is the solution? I'm arguing that it's unacceptable in international law, in international diplomacy, to have 4.5-5 million people permanently kept in a status of statelessness, which is to say kept in a status where they have no right to have rights, taken off the human rights table altogether. It's unacceptable for that to continue. So when Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu of Israel comes out and says, it's not the time yet to establish a Palestinian state, that needs to be translated. What is it saying? It's saying Palestinians must remain stateless for the time being. They must remain without rights for the time being. Well, that's not acceptable. It's not acceptable for any group of people to be deprived of basic human rights. And I think, not so much in the United States, but in the world at large, this problem is coming to the fore, and people are beginning to mobilize. So you begin to see entire governments, like the government of Ireland, the government of Norway, beginning to highlight this issue. There are moves among some European countries to raise the status of the Palestinian representation in the country to that of full embassy status. What does that do? It recognizes a Palestinian state. It's one more step towards recognizing the Palestinians as having citizenship. There are increasingly boycotts of, especially of West Bank Israeli enterprises that are making money off the exploitation of the statelessness of the Palestinians, and I expect those boycotts to grow. Israel does 50% of its foreign trade with Europe, and the Israeli economy is actually quite fragile and very dependent on international trade and international technology transfer. If the European countries have a meeting on technology, they invite the Israelis. That gradually could end if the Israelis go on like this, as people become more and more aware the Israelis are actively depriving so many people of citizenship rights. So I know some of you may feel strongly about the need for a two-state solution, the need for a Palestinian state of the West Bank and Gaza, but frankly, I think the time has probably already passed when that's plausible. There are so many settlers in the West Bank, it looks like Swiss cheese, and it's not going to happen. And then what's left is probably long-term apartheid, which, however, is not stable. I don't think that the world will put up with apartheid forever. And so there will be increasing boycotts, increasing pressure, increasing economic problems. Ultimately, it seems to me very likely that that you end up with a single state. I'm not arguing for it. I'm not saying it's desirable. I'm not saying it's the best outcome. But I think somebody has to give citizenship to the Palestinians. And increasingly, the only one that could plausibly do that is the Israelis. And the Israelis increasingly own all of Palestinian territory, so they're responsible for the people that live on that territory, even though they don't think they are. And so I don't really care how this problem is solved. From my point of view, it's all the same to me. The important thing, as you can tell, is that I insist that the Palestinians must end up with the right to have rights. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Cole, for that provocative lecture and highlighting the problem of statelessness as it relates to the Palestinians. We're going to begin our question and answer session now. Just a reminder for those watching online, this would be the time to send in a question if you have it so that we can pose it to our speaker. You could do that via Twitter by sending it to at Palestine Center. Just with a show of hands, how many questions are there from the audience in the room here? Okay, a few. So we'll start right here and work our way across. But if you can keep your questions brief and to the point and have them end with a question mark, that would be much appreciated.
Okay. My name is Haider Kat from Al-Quds Daily Newspaper. I have two quick questions. One, could you tell us about on the eve of World War I, what were the number of Jews in Israel and on the eve of can't you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay. And then at the end of the war, what were the numbers, and were they citizens of other countries? And second, if you were to give a three-step roadmap for the Palestinians currently to get out of the statelessness, what would they be?
Okay.
Thank you.
Oh, the simple question. So with regard to Jewish immigration to mandatory Palestine, there were really very few Jews in Palestine up until World War I. The Ottomans let some settlements there. So a few tens of thousands. And there had been a long-term presence in Jerusalem of, you know, pious Jewish retirees, and there were funds from Russia and so forth that supported them. So there was a Jewish presence there, but it wasn't large. Most Jews who went to Palestine went during the 30s. I mean, the Jewish population in Palestine doubled in the 30s. And while initially the ones who came in the 20s as Zionist pioneers and so forth did have multiple citizenship, had a citizenship back home and so forth. Increasingly, through the 30s, they were denaturalized. So the German Jews had the Nazis took over more and more places, they took away citizenship from the Jews every place. So by the time you got to 1940, which is really when Jewish immigration to Palestine stopped being possible from Europe because the Nazis just had taken everything. Or were beginning to control so much, the Jewish Palestinian community, the Yishuv, was about 500,000 strong, and contained very large numbers of denaturalized people, so who were otherwise stateless and who had no place to go, and many of them didn't want to be in Palestine particularly, but they couldn't get any place else. So the United States famously told them, "No, you can't come in." And even Brazil, you know, told them, "No, you can't come here." And so they were stuck without citizenship. I think with regard to your second question of how to get out of this, the strategy of getting more and more recognition as a state and then going to international institutions and pressing the case of various torts against the rights of Palestinians is the right strategy, the one that Palestine has been pursuing in the past 2 years. I think, is a real conceptual breakthrough. But it's grindingly slow. You know, nothing is going to happen overnight.
Okay. We'll go right here. Just wait one moment, ma'am, for the microphone so that we can all hear you.
Do you have to have citizen rights of some state to have human rights? And if a Palestinian's human rights were violated, for example, could another country bring suit or whatever is necessary to have those recognized?
Practically speaking, no. Practically speaking, if you don't have the rights of citizenship, then you don't have enforceable human rights. Of course, you have a script of human rights. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights makes a claim on giving rights to all human beings. But that claim isn't honored by courts and by states unless it's backed by some kind of citizenship. And that's what I'm, and claims of universal jurisdiction and so forth are very tricky. So for the most part, no. If a Palestinian has a farm on the West Bank and Israeli squatters come and take away that farm, the Palestinian could sue in Israeli courts, and very occasionally might even win. But the odds are stacked against the individual, and likely they just lose their farm, and there's nothing they can do about it.
Let's go there in the corner, and then we'll come over.
Yes, my name is Mohammed Owais, and after your depressing lecture, I am nobody, because I was born in a Palestinian tent in Ain al-Hilwa refugee camp. And I made it to Saudi Arabia very quickly and made it to the U.S. I carry a U.S. Passport. But there are many obstacles, even with the U.S. passport, in front of the Palestinians. My grandfather was fertile, 12 aunts, 11 uncles in Syria. I never seen them because we were living in Lebanon. Even with an American passport, I could not see them. In Lebanon, I was going to visit some of my aunts who live in Ain al-Hilwa. I was turned back last year because I'm a U.S. citizen, I'm not a Palestinian anymore. Egypt, I'm not allowed in Egypt because I was critical of Hosni Mubarak with his blockade of Gaza. Gaza, I'm blockaded because I talk about Hamas. Jordan, I'm not allowed in there because I question the history of the king of Jordan.
So the question,
now the question is, I was watching your PowerPoint and I saw Al-Qaeda. Don't you think all these things I mentioned will radicalize the Palestinian people, not under Al-Qaeda, because of the inhumanity of these countries?
I think we'll see the question. Let's try to get a response, because we do want to accommodate as many questions as we can.
Right. Well, obviously, not only Palestinians are radicalized by this, but also other people are radicalized by it. Most anti-American acts of terrorism are, you know, terrorists mostly don't think of themselves as evil. They are, of course, doing evil things. And terrorism is. I seem to have lost my mic. Sorry. Terrorism is directed at innocent civilians. So it's a horrible thing, but. But in their own minds, you know, this is the difference between Iron Man 3 and real reality. Nobody cackles and said, oh, how evil I am. I'm getting a kick out of being evil. They think they're saving the world by doing these things. The people who blew up London in 2005 thought they would get the British out of Iraq and then they would stop massacring Iraqis and so forth. So this problem of the Palestinian statelessness and the way they're treated evokes sympathy among people who understand the problem, and then the absolute stonewalling of the U.S. on this issue provokes anger, and then, you know, there are anti-American acts that happen because of this. It's a major impediment to the success of U.S. foreign policy, not only in the Middle East, but in the Muslim world more generally. And if you get any American diplomat in a corner where nobody else can hear the person and ask them, they all say this. They're annoyed at the extra difficulties their task faces because of this. And as Muslims, you know, are going towards being a third of the world, You know, it's very difficult to be a successful country if a third of the world is annoyed with you. So it's a real problem for the United States that they rather blithely continue to be a problem for Palestinian citizenship rather than the solution to it.
We have a question that comes to us from online that I'd like to get in here. And the question is, what would stop Israel or the U.S. from continuing to violate Palestinian rights even if they had a state, presumably on 22% of Palestine, if that state does not have the capacity to necessarily defend itself? Does statehood necessarily mean being able to secure Palestinian rights?
Right. So one of obviously, if you have a weak state or a failed state or an impaired state, it's not as good as being citizen in a strong state. But nevertheless, being citizen in any kind of a state is an advantage. And so, for instance, UN security resolutions sanctioning countries for violating human rights do have an impact. They have an economic impact. They create boycotts of various sorts. At the moment, Palestinians don't have that kind of backing. But if they had a state and the state had standing, it could go to other countries and say, another state is damaging the rights of our citizens. That is a very powerful argument in the world. So I would argue that while, you know, I'm not, there's no magic bullet, things are not suddenly going to overnight become better. The kinds of things that are being done to the Palestinians in Gaza and the West Bank, an economic boycott on the children of Gaza, for instance, or the expropriation of Palestinian land and water in the West Bank, those things could be fought back against much more handily if there were a recognized state that had standing in world bodies to do the fighting.
We're just going to take two questions at the same time now because we are running out of time. So why don't you go ahead, sir, and we'll take the question in the corner, and then we'll have you respond to them together. So we
thank you very much, Benjamin, to a retired diplomat. Following up on the last question, by the way, I agree with you on the fundamental centrality and importance of the Palestinians getting non-member observer status at the UN. What signs have you seen that the Israelis are already beginning to react to this new standing of the Palestinians? And I'd like to cite what I think is one example, and that is, for years, there was mention of the Israelis having 11,000 Palestinians in prisons. And over the past couple of years or so, that number has been going down to where now it's being talked of close to 5,000. That might be one indication. Would you like to comment on the whole thing?
And then let's take the final question here and then you can respond.
Khalil Jashan, I'm intrigued by your focus on statelessness as a central theme of the Palestinian dilemma. The only problem I have with the model is the fact that you seem to focus, or the model seems to focus, on the 4.5 million Palestinians. That's almost exactly the number that's under Israeli occupation, either in Israel proper, West Bank, and Gaza combined. But how about the rest of the 10 to 11 million Palestinians that do not seem to fit the mold here?
With regard to the new status of Palestine at the UN, the Israelis fought this tooth and nail, and they were, I think, surprised that they were defeated at the UN General Assembly. I think some Pacific Islands in the U.S. stood with them, but they're afraid that the Palestine will go to the International Criminal Court because what the Israelis are doing in the West Bank is contrary to the Statute of Rome. And Their response has not been one of fear, and I don't think that the release of prisoners has had so much to do with that, because they continue to take prisoners. In fact, one of the things they do that's contrary to international legal norms is that they arrest a lot of children. When they make a new settlement, they take land away from Palestinians. People go out to demonstrate, and they bring their families with them, and the children are often arrested by the Israelis. So they're basically, you know, taking the children hostages as a way of ensuring the behavior of the parents. So this is illegal, and they continue to do this. So I don't see a big difference in their behavior. But what they have done is to pressure the Palestinians not to go to the ICC, using the threat of aid cutoffs, and all the money for the Palestinian institutions goes through them. And last winter they cut it off. They only recently reestablished it, and then they used the Americans as the tag team to pressure the Palestinians not to do it. So I think their plan B is to try to avoid this consequence, mainly by putting pressure on the Palestinian officials. I don't think it will succeed in the long run. With regard to the issue of the Palestinians who are not under Israeli rule or are not in Syria or Lebanon, you know, who are in Jordan, for instance, and have citizenship, or in other countries that have where they've been given citizenship, I would argue that the second-class citizen status of the Palestinians in Jordan is a shadow effect of the fact that there are so many stateless Palestinians elsewhere, and that were Palestinians everywhere to have firm citizenship, it would benefit everybody. It would benefit all the Palestinians in giving them a different status in the world. But I would also say that, as somebody interested in human rights, the Palestinians living in apartment buildings, not the ones in refugee camps, but living in apartment buildings in Jordan who have Jordanian citizenship are a concern for me, because they're not full citizens in Jordan. But they're not as much a concern for me as the people in Nahr al-Bared or in the West Bank or Gaza, who are suffering the full effects of their lack of rights to have rights.
That concludes our program for today. Professor Cole, thank you very much.
Your battery went dead.
Is that what it was?
Yeah.